like this.
Okay, we're joined by Henrietta Lovell now, who's a tea expert. How are you? You're welcome. Well,
a little nervous.
Well, sorry.
I'm well, a little nervous.
We're going to talk about tea. We think we might have got these in the wrong order, so if we have, just move them around. But when we get there, we'll get there. But what makes you a tea expert? How did you become a tea expert?
Well, I travel around the world to small independent tea gardens in China, India, Africa, and I source beautiful handcrafted teas rather than big industrial ones. And I have a tea company, and you can buy my teas online, Rare Tea Company. And I supply some of the best restaurants in the world, from Fat Duck to Gordon Ramsay's Royal Hospital Road, and soon in Noma in Copenhagen.
And how did you get involved in tea in the first place?
I used to work out in China, and I remember going out to a hotel, and I was served a tea, a small pot, and it was about $200 for this pot of tea, and I thought, how can tea be $200?
Yeah.
And then I tasted it, and it was something so extraordinary, so incredible. You know, we're prepared nowadays to pay quite a lot of money for olive oil or balsamic vinegar or good wine or champagne, and there's as much range of flavour and beautiful quality in tea.
What's the difference between the tea we drink, a tea bag,
well, you know,
and normal and sort of tea you would have?
It's a little bit like the difference between an industrial process and a handcrafted process. So the difference between a turkey twizzler and a roast chicken. I mean, it looks
so there's
different.
Nothing wrong with the turkey twizzler, I mean, but the roast chicken's nicer.
It does a difference. So what's in this? Sawdust and all sorts of
stuff? No, it's just a very low-quality industrial-grade tea, and this is handcrafted by a man on a roller.
Can we taste the difference here?
Yeah.
OK. So this is the nice one.
You're going to see one has got kind of richer, deeper, rounder, more complex
flavors. I'm going to do breakfast
flavors.
First. That's breakfast.
And one is a bit more flat.
Oh, very different. Yes. A lot more flavour, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like a different beast, isn't
it?
Yeah, and when you get, and it's not, tea isn't just English breakfast tea or normal tea or builder's tea, whatever we call it, this is the black teas. But there are also a huge range of flavours and varieties, so you've got, within the same plant, the same Camellia sinensis, the same leaf can be processed to make a white tea, or a jasmine tea, or a green tea, which we've got there. They are the wrong way around.
Shall I go? Which one? This one has to go.
So that's the green tea, so that goes down there.
So that goes to the end, yeah.
So how does that difference occur then? How do they do it? Off the same plant, how do they?
It's when you pick it, how you process it. So this white tea we're going to start with today, that's picked between about the 20th of March and the 10th of April. That's the only pick. It's a spring pick. In the winter, the tea is hibernating. The bush is, all the sugars, all the polyphenols, all the good stuff goes down to the roots. And then in spring, it starts to produce its first new leaves, which is the silver tip. And so that's just dried in the sunshine, no processing, and that's a white tea.
Can we try it?
I've infused it already. These teas are so beautiful as well that you can infuse them many times. We sometimes call a tea bag tea the floozy of the tea world because it gives it all up straight away and that's it. You can't re-infuse a tea bag. Whereas it's more of a lady.
Really? You can get more out? Oh, okay.
So that's the second infusion, and they say in China the second is better than the first.
Okay.
So it costs a bit more to buy, but when you infuse it two or three times.
And temperature-wise, you don't do these boiling, do you?
Again, with a tea bag, you do need boiling water to get the flavour out of it because a lot of the amino acids with the beautiful, softer flavours are destroyed in processing, but they're not in handcrafted tea, and they dissolve at lower temperatures.
That's nice. It's really subtle.
It's really refreshing. Yeah, it is refreshing.
Sort of cut grass, hay.
Yeah.
And because it's not processed at all, it's sort of jam-packed full of the good stuff. I drink this every morning, and actually I'm about 106.
There's a weird sort of thing about the serenity of good quality teas. There's something kind of quite nice when you kind of drink that. There's something calming.
And it takes a moment to infuse, and people say, God, it's so complicated making a tea, how am I going to do it? And it's a teaspoon of tea into a teapot, and then you pour it. And if you've got a cafetiere in your home, it's really not that different. And this technology is 3,000 years old. They've been making like this for that long.
So how long do you have to infuse a tea for?
Well, with a white tea, it takes a bit longer, maybe a whole 3 minutes you might have to wait.
A whole 3 minutes?
Well, I know, but with a black tea, you know, it's only going to take 30 seconds longer than a tea bag.
Okay, tell us about this next one we're going to have.
I just got back from China where this is made. This one, if you want to pour for yourself. Tea lady has to pour.
Yes, you pour. You do it elegantly, unlike myself.
So this is a tea, of the same tea, but it's been scented with jasmine flowers. And I was just in China where they do this. And they pick the flowers, they pick the jasmine flowers while they're still buds before they're open. And then they lay them out in the evening with a layer of silver tips, the layer of the tea, on a bamboo frame. A layer of tea, then a layer of flowers, a layer of tea and a layer of flowers. And in the night, in the humidity, it's about 35 degrees, 95% humidity there in China, in Fuzhou at the moment. The flowers open, and they scent the tea. And the little tiny hairs on the bud hold on to that scent. And then they repeat the process every night for 6 nights with fresh flowers.
OK, so that tastes really a lot different from the jasmine tea that I'm used to. Why is the jasmine tea I'm used to, is it just flavoured jasmine?
Yes, it'll be an oil or a flavouring. Same with, like, Earl
Grey. It's quite harsh and it's quite perfumey. This one isn't. That actually tastes...
Yeah.
And that sounds really bizarre for you sitting at home, but this is really smooth, isn't it?
It's fantastic.
Bizarre to do the taste.
And actually, it's right. I went to a tea tasting ceremony because in Hong Kong, and I was amazed that whole kind of, you know, the whole ceremony behind it is just beautiful as well. It reminds me of that, you know, we had jasmine tea there, which is beautiful.
It's got nice mouthfeel as well. It's kind of deep.
Lovely.
Really good.
Lovely.
Interesting. It's really, really very nice with chocolate.
What's the final one?
And the final one is the green tea. And people say, oh, I don't really like green tea, but they may have only had a very harsh industrial green tea.
You pour it for some
And this is handcrafted in a wok over charcoal. Been making like this in the same place, on the same farm, for about 3,000 years. So you just get... There's no electricity on the farm. It's like, have you seen the film Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon?
Oh, I love that.
It's a bit like that up there. So, no electricity, you take charcoal and a wok, and you heat the wok.
It's really good as well. It's really smooth.
I just want to spread joy and love to the world. There is incredibly kind of
makes you very subdued.
Yeah,
it?
I mean, we could change the world with teas like this. A lot of the tea we drink is from India and Africa, and if we only drink very cheap industrial tea, they get very, very low margins on that. And if people chose their tea like they do wine for quality and for flavour, then people on tea farms could prosper and develop. Like,
is it changing? Are we getting more kind of accustomed to kind of good quality teas?
Yeah, I mean, you can buy this in some supermarkets now. I mean, people really want provenance and story, and they know that they get good coffee. They know they. It's interesting, isn't it, that coffee actually probably has helped the tea revolution, because people are getting very excited about making it properly and carefully. And I do want to say that if you're going to infuse a tea several times, which you can with a leaf tea, just make sure it's not sitting on the leaf between infusions. As soon as it's infused to how you like it, pour all the leaf, the water off, and then it's no longer cooking, and then you can infuse it again and again.
Okay, nice. Thank you very much.
Lovely.
It's not $200 worth, though, is it? It's delicious. But
no, affordable luxury. It only costs a few pence more to train up.
That's brilliant. That's really lovely. Thanks a lot, Henrietta. We're about to chat to Cara Emerald, but first, there's a race for a parking spot in this week's news.